Dan zijn we weer.
Ja, dat gaat goed.
Hello everybody and a warm welcome to this webinar by Those Vegan Cowboys. My name is Rio Pals. I'm the manager of Wurr Student Challenges, and together with my colleagues we are organizing the Rethink Protein Challenge that's running at this moment. And this webinar is part of a series of inspirational webinars around the protein transition. This particular edition of the webinars is organized with support from the University Fund Wageningen, so I would like to take this opportunity to also thank them for that. And we are very happy that Wil van den Twil and Nico Kofferman of Those Vegan Cowboys were available and willing to share their experiences and insights in developing and introducing new vegan foods. So with Those Vegan Cowboys, they're working on developing a vegan cheese, and they will share both some of the technical insights in that, as well as how they introduce these new type of products on the market. I will hand over to Will in a second so that he can start his introduction. But I would like all the viewers to know that this session is being recorded. So if you don't like to be visible in the replay, please turn off your camera. What else? Yeah, when you have questions for Will or later on with the next presentation for Nico, you can put them in the chat, and at the end of their presentation, I will pick up some of the questions from the chat so that they can respond to that. I won't take up more of your time now, so I would like to hand over to Will, and I will start your presentation now, Will. So the floor is yours.
Thanks, Rio. Good afternoon, all. Maybe a brief background about myself. I've also studied in Wageningen molecular sciences at that point of time, a long time ago, almost 40 years ago. Did a PhD afterwards, and then I started working within the industry a long time with DSM. And during the last 2 years, also working for startups, and my biggest task is related to those vegan cowboys. I've always worked in new business development, developing processes and scaling processes. Let me tell you a little bit more about those vegan cowboys, and what Nico and I would like to do is to tell you a little bit on the technology, the approach we have. And after that, Nico, especially with respect to the branding, the marketing that we are doing, the use of the social media, etc. Let me go, and now I have to use this. Yeah. What I would like to address today is to tell you a little bit more about the dairy market and also the challenges related to the production of dairy products. A little bit with respect to the history and the background of those vegan cowboys. I'm saying a little bit because Nico will also tell more about that. Our current focus, and then especially also how are we executing our plan, and why do we believe that we can be successful. And again, after that, Nico will take over. Dairy products, let me go to the next slide. Dairy products are huge products. It's a huge market. Dairy products have a high nutritional value and are produced and consumed on a very large scale all over the world. For example, if you look at cheese, which is one of the main products, it has a value globally of about 150 billion euro. even when you look at the caseinates, because they are also used apart from cheese, they're used in food and even in non-food applications, that they have a market value of $3 billion euro or dollars. When you look at the global vegan cheese market, that is, however, a very small market. It's almost 2% of the traditional cheese market. And that has to do especially with the fact that there are still a lot of unmet needs, and I will come back to that. Let's briefly address in the next slide the environmental impact of producing milk, of producing dairy products. When we look at land use, about 70% of the land is currently used to feed livestock. And also when you look at CO2 emissions, that is very huge. We have lots of cows, about 300 million worldwide, dairy cows. And every dairy cow emits a CO2, which is equal to a regular car. So those are enormous amounts. And when you then also look at water usage, which is high, about 1,000 liters is required for 1 liter of cow milk. Combine that with the issues we have here in the Netherlands, but also in other places in the world, with respect to nitrogen emissions. And then there are also the methane that is emitted by the cows. So we are looking at an enormous environmental impact. In addition to that, also animal welfare is often compromised. So if you look at all of this, you say, especially also looking towards the future, something has to change. We need a more sustainable production of these type of products. And again, here you see a picture on the right of Nico together with Jaap Korteweg, the two founders of the Vegetarian Butcher. The Vegetarian Butcher, and Nico will tell much more about that, was related to alternative meat products, plant-based meat products with a good taste. Now, that company they have established, they have sold to Unilever. That was the end of 2018, beginning of 2019. So you could say that mission was accomplished. And now Jaap and Nico, after having accomplished that, they focus now on dairy products, to make dairy products more sustainable and also take the cow out of the production chain. Let me tell you more on that. Here you see some pictures how milk was collected in the past and also looking towards the future. We started with hand milking, machine milking came thereafter, and nowadays it's done by robots. However, if you look at that and that overall process, that is a very inefficient process, as we addressed earlier. So we view that it is time to take the cow out of that production process and replace it by an iron cow. Here you now see a slide which I borrowed from Provac. Provac did last year a large survey. They went into shops and asked consumers what they are missing most when they look at plant-based food products. What are the big pain points? And what clearly came to the surface was that cheese was mentioned most. When you want to have a plant-based alternative for cheese, that is in fact not there. The taste is not good. The mouthfeel and the texture are not far not what people want them to be, far not comparable to the current products. So that's also one of the reasons that we say we want to focus on especially on cheeses and the ingredients that are required for making those cheeses. And the most important ingredient in cheese and even in milk is casein. About 80% of the protein in milk is are the caseins. And similar to what Jaap and Nico had been doing with the vegetarian butcher, using existing ingredients and then making a good product out of it, we had a look again at the plant-based kingdom, whether casein-like proteins were available there. However, they aren't available in plants. And so knowing that, we said, yeah, an alternative way to make them is to use microbial fermentation to produce these type of proteins. So caseins is our focus, but when we look at the broader community, we see that nowadays there are lots of companies that are focusing on the production of milk proteins. Let me stop this. There are lots of companies focusing on milk proteins. Quite a lot are employing microbial techniques to produce them, but there are also a few who are applying mammary gland cells for producing these type of products. One company that started already quite some time ago, that is Perfect Day. Perfect Day started in 2014. And what we see the last 2 years is that a lot of additional companies have emerged and are now looking at these type of products, both the caseins as well as the beta-lactoglobulin and some other milk. Our view on this is that, yeah, in a way, it is good that there are a lot of people, a lot of companies addressing this this target, because it is quite a challenge, and together we can help, and together we will be able to address that and develop technologies that are more sustainable. And we strongly believe that we can contribute to that. How do we want to do that? How do we go about? And that is depicted in this slide. So it's really a combination of disciplines. We need the molecular biology to insert the gene of interest in a microorganism. In our case, we are looking especially at yeast and fungus. Thereafter, we have to use fermentation to produce those proteins at a higher concentration. And here that is depicted. Here you see the caseins. Subsequently, when you have the caseins, you have to isolate them and have to put them together again towards caseins to ultimately convert the casein micelles to a cheese that has the characteristics that we are going for. So a cheese that has a good taste, a good texture, a good mouthfeel. So when you want to be successful, you have to address and work with all these disciplines. And as a matter of fact, that's what we have been doing. And that is depicted in this slide. We started the beginning of last year, so you could say we are a year on the road now. Recognizing that it is not only the overexpression of the caseins, And by the way, it's not one casein, there are multiple caseins. We said we need to start with a significant research group to address that and ultimately be successful. And that's what we have done. The beginning of last year, we acquired a research group in Belgium, in Ghent, of about 20 people. And here you see our cowboys, molecular biologists, fermentation specialists, protein specialists, working together to address, in this case, the development of caseins and producing that by fermentation. We have expanded the group, and we are still expanding this group. So if there are people having an interest, let us know. Maybe there is an opportunity also for you there. The next slide shows our workhorses. So yeah, every cowboy has his horses. We have them too. And here you see them, the fermenters, our iron cows, still at the lab phase later on, that should turn into larger scale fermentations. What we also need to ultimately be successful is strain development, process development, micelle formation, cheese formation, and also regulatory is very important. I didn't mention that yet, but regulatory, we are producing the caseins via a host that we have modified. So here in Europe, we need to go via novel food dossier, get the regulatory approval. The same holds true, for example, in the US, where we need a GRAS approval, FDA approval to ultimately bring this and commercialize these type of products. When we look at our development trajectory, we really are in favor of open innovation. We want to do that together with others. We want to use also the expertise that and knowledge that is available in the outside world. And I think a nice example of that is the bounty hunt. And especially Nico was in favor of doing this. And that is shown also in the next slide. Here you see that we have a bounty hunt for people who can help us to find and optimize the best strain for producing the caseins. So if one of you would still have something in the refrigerator which could help us in one way or another, please contact us. There is still money that can be granted to somebody who has a good idea. So please do. Collaborations, I mentioned it, the bounty hunt, open innovation, collaborations are also very important. Yes, we have acquired a group at the beginning that has a long history and track record with respect to genetic engineering and expressing mammalian proteins in yeast. So that was a good step, but we also realized that we still need to build a lot of additional knowledge. And we are doing that via collaboration, and that holds true for strain and process development. That also holds true for micelle and cheese formation. And that's depicted in this slide. When we look at strain development, process development, we are collaborating with a few other institutes and companies who have specific expertise in that field, especially when we look at fungal technologies. And also when you look at the micelle formation, there are experts in the world, and especially at the Wageningen University and also at the University of Kent, who have been working already a long time in this field. And we have set up collaborations with them to progress the work we are doing. Let me see. Yeah, what you see here is that what is new here on this slide is an arrow. I mentioned before, if you look at what we are doing, it's not only the overexpressing of proteins, but also combining those proteins again, and ultimately combining them with fats, combining them with some sugar to make a good tasting cheese out of it. So we foresee that it will take quite some years to develop this technology, and especially also in view of regulatory, which will take again 1 to 2 years, depending on the location. In the US, it will go quicker. That process is quicker. Here in Europe, it very likely will take at least 2 years. In addition to all of this, to technology development, what is also very important is understanding the market. And especially when you come closer to making a product, what are the unmet needs? How can we approach that market best? So we are looking into that aspect as well. And another aspect is branding. And especially Nico will come back on that topic. When we look at market development and getting a better understanding of the market, we have, end of last year, set up a collaboration, a joint venture with Westland Kaas. Westland Kaas is, I would say, a quite famous cheese producer who doesn't know Old Amsterdam and Maaslander, known all over the world. And together with Westland, we want to bring sustainable plant-based cheeses to the market. And I think Nico can tell more on it, because already in the very near future, we want to bring something towards the market, middle of 2021. Here we have a slide on our communication, the use of the various social media. We get a lot of attention, and we are using that also to bring the message to the world, to the relevant stakeholders. And again, Nico will dive into that in more detail. So why do we believe that we will be successful, that we will contribute to the goal we have set? That is, we have acquired an experienced R&D group, an experienced R&D group we have also a good infrastructure, that is our lab in Kent. Also, when you look at the Netherlands and Belgium, you can say that's the land of milk and cheese. We have a long history. There are strong networks that we will use. If you look at the people who are behind it, they have a strong track record in developing a business, commercializing new products, and the network they have gathered there in the past, we are using that to be also successful with this enterprise. People recognize that also the strength that we have in brand building will be of relevance here. Yeah, while executing our strategy and realizing our plans, there will be some side effects. And that goes back to also the environmental impact. Introducing fermentative production processes for the caseins or other milk proteins will significantly reduce the land use. We have made some calculations and we have also compared that with others. Our estimate is that we only need 20% of the current land use to produce the same amount of proteins. A similar reduction we also expect to see with respect to the carbon footprint and also the water usage. Of course, also when you look at nitrogen emissions, methane emissions, that will be significantly lower. So overall, a much better environmental footprint. And as addressed earlier, yeah, also animal welfare issues will be left where they belong. Concluding remarks. As mentioned, the dairy market is a huge market with a high environmental impact. And consequently, there is a growing need and also a growing understanding that we need to produce those products much more sustainable. When you look at fermentation, we believe there is a great opportunity there for fermentation to address and develop more sustainable technologies. We, as those vegan cowboys, we have the guts, we have the experience, and we are also strongly committed to succeed here. Let me close off with this and open the session for a Q&A. And thereafter also Nico will dive more into the branding and the marketing.
Thank you very much, Will. That was a fascinating story and a very different approach, I would say. I saw quite some questions in the chat. I'm not as sure that we can take them all because we want to leave sufficient time for Nico as well. But I'm going to pick up a few. Alessandro is asking, how does the nutritional value of vegan cheese compare to that of normal cheese?
Now, I would say the nutritional value will be the same, and we even could make it somewhat better because now we have the possibility to formulate the cheese to mix the casein micelles together with fat ingredients and sugar in a way that we wanted. So we even have more flexibility there.
Okay, that's good to hear. Then there's a question by Rolien. How's the cheese from Vegan Cowboys different from vegan cheese from VioLife? They have several types of cheeses in supermarkets today.
Yeah. If you look at VioLife cheese, some people say, can you call that a cheese? But it's the main component is modified starch, and sometimes it also contains a little bit of protein. So going back to the nutritional value in those products, that is of course not comparable to the current cheeses, so that is not the type of product we want to make. We want to make a cheese where about 25% is protein and not only a few percent.
Okay, that's clear. Then a question from Maria Clara. She's wondering if there are research projects or things like internships, etc., in the Vegan Cowboys for people interested who are not food tech oriented. So, for example, an environmental or climate science person.
at this point of time, that specific expertise, I think, is a little bit less. But for sure, we will have to make LCA assessments, etc. So in due time, there could be possibilities. And when there is a specific interest, I would say, let us know and let's see whether at that point of time, there is an opportunity.
Okay. Then one last question, and then we switch to Nico. Marlou is asking, are there any food safety issues to be alert for?
The short answer is no. And why is that? We are producing a casein that is identical to the casein, for example, in cow. We will be using strains, fungi, that are food grade, have a history of food use. And in addition to that, we will have to investigate and to show also in the regulatory dossiers that it is safe. Independent how the fermentation goes, independent how the downstream processing is being done, that in all cases the product is safe and does not cause any harm to humans.
Right. Well, thank you. I'd like you to introduce yourself, and in the meantime, I will start your presentation.
Okay. Well, my name is Nico Kofferman. I'm a co-founder of The Vegetarian Butcher and the co-founder of Those Vegan Cowboys. And apart from that, I'm a member of the Dutch Senate for the Party for the Animals, which party I founded in 1992. Well, occasionally I met Jaap Korteweg in France on a campsite. And well, it's not always a guarantee for a good conversation if somebody of the Party for the Animals meets a farmer. And we were there having dinner, and well, we had a lot in common. And Jaap told me that during the great pig pest culling 1997-1998, 11 million pigs were killed, and he has an organic farm, a crop farm. And the authorities came to him and said to him, well, we haven't enough destruction capacity, so can we store 20,000 dead pigs in your cooling houses? And he could earn a lot of money with it, but Jaap decided not to be involved in this way. So he said no. And then he realized that that should also have some consequences for his personal life. So he decided to become an ethical carnivore, whatever that may be. But in the first place, he decided only to eat meat outside, so be a vegetarian at home. And when he found himself more and more eating outside, out of home, in a restaurant, he realized that being an ethical carnivore wouldn't work for him. So on this campsite, we had this fantasy just to establish a vegetarian butcher. And well, on holiday, you can have a lot of fantasies, but when you're home, some things will differ. But 1 week after holiday, Jaap called me and said, well, when are we going to start with this operation? And I said, well, Jaap, you don't have a clue. I don't have a clue how to make meat from grains. So, well, I'm not sure if this will be a success. And he said, well, I can guarantee you that I'm going to get my whole pension fund in it, and you are going to put your whole pension fund in it. And well, the chance that it will not be a success will be 90%. So well, I had to ask my wife if she thought it was a good idea, and she said, yes, that's a great idea, so do it. So we started the Vegetarian Butcher, which was a world first. And a lot of colleagues of mine in the marketing business said to me, well, this sounds to us like a commercial suicide, because a vegetarian will never go to a butcher and a meat lover will never go to a shop saying it's vegetarian. So, it's not very... The chance to have a success will not be very big. So, still, we started this little store in The Hague, and it was looking like a butcher store from the 1920s, with one difference, just no animals involved. So our ambition from day one was to be the world's biggest butcher, not the world's biggest vegetarian butcher, but the world's biggest butcher. And we started cooperations with chefs and technologists and scientists, and we developed new meat products just from plant-based materials. And from the beginning, we had a very successful team. So we entered competitions from the Telegraaf, newspaper in the Netherlands, and they had a competition who can make the best meatball in the Netherlands. And we didn't tell them that it wasn't meat, our entry, but we won the bronze medal. So we were competing with 50 meatballs and just one not meat meatball, and still we got a third place. And 1 year later we entered a competition for the best new food product in the Netherlands, and we entered with a smoked eel salad, and the jury said, well, this is the best smoked eel salad we ever tasted. So we won the grand prize. And Nick and Simon, two singers in the Netherlands from Volendam, a fishery village, tasted our smoked eel salad, and they said, well, it has to be smoked eel from Volendam because it's the best we ever had. We started after let's say a few years with 4,000 outlets in 14 countries. And nowadays we have 40,000 outlets in 40 countries. Our first product was vegan chicken chunks, established together with Oya from Wageningen. We gave it this vegan chicken chunks to different people like Ferran Adria, who happened to be the best chef in the world those days. And we asked him, how do you like this chicken? And he said, well, how do I like this chicken? Well, it's definitely chicken thigh. I think it's organic, maybe free range, maybe from the south of France. So he was totally confused when he heard it was a vegan product. And we gave it also to Mark Bittman, who is the food critic of the New York Times. And he said, well, I'm not in favor of the concept of meat analogs, but because if you don't like to eat meat, just don't eat meat, just eat vegetables. But now I taste this, I would say, why should we use a chicken as a machine which make meat if there is a machine which can make meat-like products which resemble chicken? So the publicity from those guys was very big for us. So we were growing very fast. We introduced a burger in France, in Paris, in the culinary capital of Europe. And this burger has a footprint which was 7 times smaller than the regular beef burger, but the taste was almost the same. We had a lot of troubles with the food authorities in the Netherlands. They came to us and they say, you cannot call your product gehakt, because gehakt is a reserved term for meat products. And we said, well, we don't call it gehakt. we call it gehackt. And they said, well, that's just one letter difference. And we said, no, it's a total difference because we are hacking the meat. So, well, those guys were conferencing many days on this, but after all, they left it like we wanted. Well, Schnitzelgate is still going on. A lot of legislators and lobbyists, are looking at possibilities to stop plant-based meat or plant-based dairy because of the growth of the sector. And in the European Parliament, there was a debate about veggie discs, which could replace burgers under European food labeling proposals. So they said, you cannot call a product a burger or a sausage or a steak if it's not derived from animals. And they had the same debate on dairy. Well, the discussion ended that the meat products were allowed to be called sausage or burger, but the debate on the dairy products is still going on. Well, I've worked myself in advertising for almost 30 years, and I know that a lot of advertising money is just spent on, well, not successful activities. So we decided not to spend a single euro on advertising and to focus on emotional distinction. Our product was indistinguishable from the real thing in a blind test. We asked people to betray their partner at least once a week, and a lot of people did so. So a lot of our customers are high educated ladies, and they betrayed their partners. Well, it sounds like old fashioned, but still a lot of women are just the shoppers and the cookers. And a lot of men are not doing much on preparing the meal. So we asked them, betray your partner. And yes, they did. And they got a lot of free publicity on social media on this. A lot of people were posting photographs about their pets loving our products, or their children, or their husbands, or people around them. And we had different stakeholders, you could say. This is Professor Adsian van der Goot in Wageningen. Maybe you know him. We built a machine together with the Wageningen team, which was a Coetzel. And this Coetzel was able to make plant-based steaks as large as, well, limited sizes, let's say as large as a garage door. This project is still going on in Wageningen. We did a lot of co-creation with different parties. We did a co-creation with Albert Heijn. We said, well, the Ross on the left is not vegan and 12 million euros. And the Ross on the right are the vegan satay rolls, and well, the vegan satay rolls are just 120 for two, so that's a lot cheaper than the rolls on the left. We did a co-creation with Mora, which is one of the biggest snack producers in the Netherlands. Here you see Cora van Mora together with Jaap, and we had a food truck asking people on the roads how they did like our croquettes, our meat croquettes. And a lot of people were very confused when they heard there was no meat in it. We did a co-creation with Unox. They had meatballs in satay sauce, and we made vegetarian gehackt balls in satay sauce. And they put it on the shelf in the supermarkets in a space where vegetarians never will come. And after 3 months, 30% of the turnover was from the vegetarian meatballs. Well, in 2019, the vegetarian butcher acquired Unilever. So Unilever is going to turn vegan on a lot of product categories, from sausage to ice cream. They in between they have about 700 products which are labeled as vegetarian or vegan. And our joint strategy is to pick out animals. So they say we will go vegan, and the vegetarian butcher will be our flagship store in this process. Not many people know that Unilever is vegan since 1872. They were big in the beginning with margarines, so let's say a substitute for butter. And well, they also did a lot of products with meat in it, but also a lot of vegan and vegetarian products. After the cooperation with Unilever, we did a co-creation with Burger King, which is very successful. The new Vegan Royale was introduced yesterday, I think, and the new plant-based Whopper was introduced last year. And those two products are very successful, and they also have vegan chicken nuggets nowadays. Well, the next step is those Vegan Cowboys. We follow the same road in terms of publicity. So we are using a lot of free publicity, and we are not advertising in commercial media. Will told you about the bounty hunt. So we had a reward of 2.5 million euros for those who can help us with this operation. And the cooperation, the joint venture we made with Westland Kaas, which is one of the most famous cheese makers in the Netherlands, will be in the first products will be in the retail in June of this year. And we decided together with Westland Kaas that 100% of the turnover of this joint venture will be invested in developing vegan cheese, hard cheeses. So I think that's my presentation up till now. So if there are any questions, please let me know.
Thank you, Nico. Wow, that was a brave step into a very uncertain future, but yeah. You made it a great success,
yeah.
With a lot of commitment, I think. Let me check in the chat if we have any questions. Yes, there's a question from Rolina. She says, most of the products from the vegetarische slager are made from soy. I guess this has to do with special technical properties of soy, such as protein fibers. Would there be other raw materials which can provide similar properties besides soy?
Yeah. Well, soy has, well, let's say the property of gelating and structuring products. So soy is the best source at the moment to make meat analogs, but we are also working with pea proteins and lupin.
And lupin, does it come from the Netherlands or from abroad?
From Netherlands, yeah.
Okay. That's nice. So far, that is the only question. If there are any people listening that have additional questions, please put them in the chat so that we can ask Nico to respond to that. I was actually wondering, you mentioned the gehackt ball. I understood that a little while ago there was a similar issue with non-dairy dairy products.
Yeah.
And the EU wants to ban the use of dairy-related terminology for non-dairy products. Oh, We lost Nico. Nico, can you hear us? Ah.
Yeah.
There yeah. We are. Okay. Good. Your camera is still off, I think. Ah, here yeah. You are. Okay. Did you get the end of my question?
Yeah. There was a problem with dairy products as well. But we think that the harder they make it, the tougher we go. So it's no problem to us. It's let's say a last try of the meat industry to or the dairy industry to stop us. But we think this development will be unstoppable. So it's not about. The naming in the Netherlands, there's a vegan yogurt brand which call themselves Joch, so that's Joch without the herd.
Mm.
So, rainforest, so we don't buy soy in South America, so our soy is coming from Europe and Northern America. We have also had we've also grown our own soy in the Netherlands, so that's possible. It's not nice that it's possible already to grow soy in the Netherlands because that's about climate change, but still it is possible. But the main sourcing now is from Europe, and it's not about let's say problems with rainforest, so we don't like it. And people who are concerned about soy from rainforest shouldn't eat meat, because 7 times more soy is sourced for meat and dairy than we are using for dairy or meat analogs.
Yeah, well, that's a good point too. Let's see. I have another few questions. Mareva's asking, as a person allergic to gluten, it is not easy to find gluten-free vegan alternatives. Are you developing options for people with food allergies?
Yeah, well, we don't produce products especially for dietary problems. But our cheese will be without gluten, I suppose.
Mm. Okay. And then we have a question from Katrinus. Hard cheese is ripening in time. How will you mimic this?
Well, exactly the same. So it's being produced like the cheeses we know at the moment are ripened. And especially Westland Kaas, Old Amsterdam.
Van Bouwman, for the vegan cowboys, do you see an opportunity for small-scale processing directly on the farm?
Yeah. Well, Jaap Korteweg is a farmer himself. And the other companies who are working on microbial cheese or milk, dairy, are using sugars, but there was a special request from Jaap to use grass to produce it, so that dairy farmers in the Netherlands can still produce grass, but just without animals, and they can use their stables to produce, well, let's say, homemade cheese or regional cheeses. Yeah.
That would be an interesting turn in their career, I think.
So.
And we have a question by Philippe. Why always develop meat mimics?
Yeah, well, that's people are working on meat mimics from the 1920s, and they had one characteristic in common. It was it was looking like meat, but it was not tasting like meat. It doesn't have the structure of meat or the bite of meat or the nutritional value, so it wasn't meat. And when I met Jaap, well, I'm a born vegetarian, so for me tofu and tempeh are fine. I'm I'm raised with tofu and tempeh. But Jaap said, well, I'm a meat addict. And for me, it has to resemble all characteristics of meat. So especially for his personal meat, we worked on mimicking meat. And well, let's say there are not many people eating meat because they like to kill animals. It's just because the taste and the structure and all other characteristics. So, well, a lot of it's totally different. And that's also with meat. We don't have the ambition to make something completely different. Why should we? People love meat. People love all the characteristics of meat. So that's the reason we are trying to convert meat addicts to sustainable meat.
Well, I think that's a good mission. Thank you. I think that was the last question that came in. We could pick up one more question that came in after Will's session. I'll read it out and then one of you can respond. I don't know who is better to address that. It's a question from Kaisa. She's saying, the development phase of such novel biotechnologies is very long. How are you planning to tackle the long and costly development part before revenue streams from the cheese are established?
Yeah, let me make a comment on it and then Nico can add. I think what Nico has been explaining already is that there is a very strong commitment, a very strong commitment from Nico and Jaap, and probably also selling the vegetarian butcher to Unilever makes that also possible, because indeed it is a long way requiring lots of money. We have a strong commitment. We have a strong group working together with others. All of that, combining that, we believe we can be successful. But maybe Nico, you want to add something to that as well?
Yeah. Well, when we sold our company to Unilever, a lot of people said, "What are you going to do?" A lot of investors are aware of the fact that it's very old-fashioned to take some plant-based proteins, to put them into an animal, to lose 90% of the calories and just have 10% of the calories after killing the animal. So we think that it has a great future to make plant-based products, which resemble the old-fashioned products, and money will not be a problem in that.
Well, thank you both for the response to that. And I guess with this, we're coming to the end of the webinar today. I was really, really impressed by your dedication and your innovative approach also. So great to now know a little bit more about that. And I would like to thank you very much for taking the time to share this with us all. And we'll follow you with interest.
Thank you. And
to the listeners, thank you for being here. And next week we have another webinar coming up. So please check out the topic and register if you're